small space. Welcome to Silver Center for the Arts. My name is Amanda Whitworth, and I am a professor of dance and part of the faculty team in music, theater, and dance here at Silver. We are part of the Arts and Technologies cluster here on campus, and in this building, we're so happy to welcome back patrons for live performance, which is excellent. But the miracle of technology is also allowing us to welcome people from home and remote locations, so welcome to everyone on Zoom. So today it is my total pleasure to introduce all of you to Michael Winward. Michael is an interdisciplinary artist, a dance maker, a storyteller, and a human with a huge heart who does many things with movement and with theater. He does that by creating works for performance, by advocating for people in his community, and for building relationships and bridges between all of those things. He'll talk a little bit more about his experience as we go through the evening. So this is meant to be sort of like a living room conversation. So even though we're on the stage here, if you're here with us live, just raise your hand or shout out if you have questions. We're happy to take those. If you're on Zoom, that's why I have my computer here. So I'll be monitoring the chat. I'll also be putting resources in the chat. And then as Michael moves towards performance, so he's going to show some performance on the screen, and then he's going to do some live. I'll throw in the script for the live performance, and everything that goes up on the screen will be captioned, okay? So we'll have little breaks here and there to talk about Michael's work. He is so multifaceted, and his mind is just overflowing with many interesting things. So we will get to that. So Michael, I'm going to hand it to you.
Yay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all for coming. Thanks for being here. And if you were in class this morning, thanks for coming to that, too. That was a lot of fun for me. So thanks. Thanks, everyone. Good to see you. Again, as Amanda said, my name is Michael Winward. I tend to talk fast. You can ask me to slow down. Whether you're here in the room or on the Zoom, just if you need that, just please let us know, because I sometimes do. Amanda was just giving me that note earlier today, so thank you. If anyone has any access needs in particular, let us know. As Amanda said, raise your hand, put it in the chat. I want to thank my friend and colleague, Amanda Whitworth, for having me here for these couple of days to share the performance work, and also integral to my practice is working in community and teaching and being with multiple ways of being in a room and moving together. So thank you. And I also want to thank Dr. Nick Helms for the invitation to be part of the intersectionality talks, as well as their help in learning more about the land where I am in the process of visiting, which is very important to me. So as you'll see, I dance, I write, and then a big part of my practice is memorizing the words that I write and then dancing them or trying to. So there's a lot of memorization, and if you'll forgive me, just in these moments, I have my notebook here and I'm reading some of it from the page only because I don't want to forget in these welcoming and acknowledgments. So we're gathered here on Indakana land, and I'm very grateful to be here. This is the ancestral homeland of the Abenaki, Penacook, and Wabanaki peoples past and present. I want to acknowledge with honor and gratitude the land, the waterways, the rooted, the swimming, the winged, the two-legged, the four-legged, and then the Albonac, the people. Alnobak, I'm sorry, I want to say it correctly. The Alnobak, the people who have stewarded this land for generations. Abenaki people trace history and connection to this land over 12,000 years, and that's very humbling for me, which I'll talk about in a second. For the first time I spent some time at the Pemijuwasit today. It was just important to go and be there. It's very cold, it's very still. If you follow it south, that's south, right? If we follow it south enough, it turns into the Merrimack, and it spills out onto Pawtucket Falls, which is in the land where I was born and raised. The traditional ancestral name of that land is Nabnasset. It's a village of the Massachusetts Nation, and these days it's commonly referred to as Lowell, so named after Francis Cabot Lowell, who's a big player in the Industrial Revolution, and that's a big history of this place as well. More recent history is of a mill town. So I hold that in my heart and in my mind and in my consciousness, and I think about my own biological family line. We trace our lineage here from Ireland, England, and France. And in doing some of that work of figuring out where we came from and when, the longest anyone that I could find through obituaries mostly and some genealogy is less than 300 years on this land. And so when I hold these numbers, I mean, if I think of the Abenaki people in a greater than 12,000 year history and then a less than 200 year history, that's really humbling to me. And it's it makes me think about and consider and reconsider what it means to be an invited guest, as in this circumstance, and I'm very grateful for that, and also the many ways, many more profound ways in which I'm an uninvited guest. And so I think about, like, well, what are the responsibilities attending to that? And so I just wanted to talk about that a little bit, and to name that, again, thanks to Dr. Helms and for Amanda to being open to having this dialogue and to beginning in this way. So again, thinking about those responsibilities, I now want to show gratitude for two organizations that maintain websites that were very helpful to me, and we'll drop them in the chat, and I'll name them into the space. I say them because my website's a little out of date, and so I know how hard it, I know what it means to try to update a website and keep it up to date, so I appreciate. The first is newer to me, the Indigenous New Hampshire Collaborative Collective, which is indigenousnh.com. So this helped me in the research of understanding more about this place. There's a ton of videos and blog posts and historical information and also action items that we can take in support of Indigenous futurity and sovereignty. And then the website I'm more familiar with is that of the Massachusetts Indigenous Legislative Agenda. So that's maindigenousagenda.org. So one of the commonalities between these websites is that push to officially celebrate Indigenous Peoples Day and to stop celebrating Columbus Day. That's one of five bills of the Mass Indigenous Legislative Agenda. It's very present in my mind because it was just earlier this month, so still in February, that four of these bills were in committee. Two got voted favorably out of committee and two did not, which means that they're not up for a vote again until January of 2023. And one of them is to stop celebrating Columbus Day and to start celebrating Indigenous Peoples Day in Massachusetts. So the idea that that's going to take a whole other year to even approach that conversation again, I hold that piece of information with me, and I just want to name that into the space. And then the other bill that did not pass was a bill that would institute Native-informed curricula in the public schools about Native American history and culture. And when I think about what's painful about that not passing this year is, like, you know, I really wish I had that when I was in the Massachusetts public school system. Like, I wish I had that information, because then it wouldn't have been until I'm in my early to mid-30s when I can take the word Navnasset and associate it with the land where I was born and raised, as opposed to the golf club and country course. Did I get that right? Country club, golf course, you know, I got it mixed up because I don't care about either of those two. You know, uses for land, right? So, again, I'm thinking about those responsibilities, and the legislation is present in my mind because for us in Massachusetts, it's very recent. It's still this month that didn't happen, and it's a celebration that two bills did pass and are moving forward. And I also want to name that, like, well, of all the things one can do to be supportive, like speaking about legislation is, you know, that's a state sort of activity. And so I think there's a dissonance there. And yet I also appreciate the fact that it can start a conversation. So that is that part. So thank you for bearing witness to that. And then the last thing I'll say before we can kind of get into the conversation and the performance is that I show a lot of gratitude to my family because, as you will see, my immediate family become my creative collaborators because it's our home movies that I use to generate some of my performance. So I thank them, my dad, my mom, and my sister. And the new piece I'm going to be showing tonight, there's no video projection, but it's the first time I've worked closely in collaboration with some dramaturgs and folks who have helped me get to this place with this piece. It wouldn't be without their input. So they are Betsy S. Goldman, E.J. Joseph, Catherine Siller. I want to thank all of them for all of the bearing witness to this work that's gone on. And then also to Shanice Grant's show. Thank you for your ASL interpretation. We wouldn't be able to have this process without show either. And thank you, Amanda Whitworth. I'm so excited. Thank you for having me. Yeah. I'll turn this back over to you.
Great. So you'll see across Michael's work that he thinks about his life in terms of work and family and faith. And the things that he has been bubbling on, they may seem disparate when you first hear about them, but you'll see that they're all connected when you look at his art and then hear him talk about it. And I want to ask you about how your journey has shifted and changed most recently. So what I do know about Michael is that his first sort of home base in movement was as a modern dancer, but then later he found ballroom dance, and that ended up being an interesting kind of home for a while, right? Or still. And through that discovery and that process, he found lots of different stories and lots of different ways to move through the world. So I'm interested in, like, right now, what's on your mind? What's bubbling? What are you thinking about? How have you come to think about diversity? How have you come to think about the ways we name land? How have you come to the spaces where you're thinking about opening your mind and your understanding to what you might have been taught before?
I will talk about the fact that positionality is forefront of my mind, and thinking of I deal with a lot in these scenarios with storytelling, and often, like, if I can, humorous storytelling, I value that. And so, again, what are the responsibilities that are attendant to that in a performance environment? I think one of the things you might be referencing, Amanda, is that I'm currently enrolled in a MFA master's program at Goddard College, which has a campus in Vermont, and then also has a campus in Port Townsend in Washington. And that's the campus where I'm enrolled because they have the Decolonial Arts Praxis Concentration. And it's on Sklalom land, on the Salish Sea. I just got to spend 8 days there being in community and in ceremony and with people that I've only ever known on Zoom up until that time. And so I want to name the school and that opportunity for learning, because for me it's like I don't really want to breathe the word decolonization until I'm thinking deeply about not just how this would apply to an art praxis, you know, or my mind, me as an individual, but also to consider what are the geopolitical aspects of that. Just to keep that awareness front of mind in not only in creating work, but also in thinking about the systems that support it, and how to let go of systems that feel like we're not working for the sake of equity, for example, and what it actually means to build ones that are going to serve us generations into the future. And ballroom dancing is one example of that for me, because I spent, as you'll hear, I spent some time working in a franchise ballroom system, which, you know, it provided so much information, and I want to hold gratitude for that too. But, you know, there's a lot about that I kind of bristle up against, and so trying to rethink how to take that practice and make something that feels meaningful for me from it, which is part of some of the work that I do in elder care communities. In fact, that is, like, primarily my job, which is to bring ballroom dancing into assisted living and mind care communities, and for to be able to think about that sort of non-medical touch, or that way to approach a partner for the sake of dancing as a way to enact care, and finding systems for care within that.
So as part of Michael's visit on campus, he'll be working with our nursing students tomorrow and talking about touch in relation to his experience working with patients with Alzheimer's and dementia. So very exciting context for movement. So tell us what we're gonna see now.
Yeah, so this is a piece I want to credit. My friend and colleague Peter DeMuro is the artistic executive director of the Dance Complex, which is in Cambridge, Mass. And we've worked together closely for some years now. So the piece you're about to see was created in residence at the Dance Complex through their Catalyst Residency Program. It's a short 5-minute piece. And then it also ended up being able to have life inside Peter's own annual holiday performance, which is about chosen family and what it means to move through the world as a gay person or a queer person, and how we celebrate the holidays. And there, you know, there's a generational difference between us, which when that fuels our conversations in many ways. And so, this was an opportunity to take. Well, I'll also say that my father, who is the one that films the home movies that that I'm using as the backdrop to this, at one point when I was in my, you know, early 20s, said, "Hey, how about you put that in the dance?" I was like, "Oh, all right, fine." I didn't think he expected I'd be doing it like now, you know, all these years later. But yeah, it's Christmas morning. I think I was 8. So this is, yeah. Oh, the same procedure as last year, which references a movie, which I can, I could just keep talking, so we'll just, I'll stop talking.
Okay, we'll put that in there.
Qui c'est qui est assis aujourd'hui, Michael?
Mike.
Moi, je suis bon, c'est bon, c'est le chef. Oh, what is it?
Mommy!
Oh, you like it, yeah.
I like that book, man.
But I've got more gifts to see it.
does your family feel about you using the videos?
My mom likes that you can't see her in it. And my sister goes, oh, my voice. And we're like, yeah, that's what everyone says, or at the time. And yeah, they I think, find the, no, they've told me they find the humor in it. Yeah, and I've shown them these pieces. The very first one, I think I mentioned earlier, that I made was using footage of me, like, singing and dancing in the backyard, and I made that piece when I was 22. And again, my dad was like, I was like, I don't know what I'm going to do for the end of this dance. He's like, well, we got this footage of you singing when you're, like, 8 years old. I was like, oh, why there might be something in that. So, yeah, they get it, and they're cool with it. And there's something to me that's important about, like, well, I've always been that person, but there's some fundamental things I understand about myself now that I didn't then, you know, and so that juxtaposition feels interesting to me. And I think they appreciate that that's part of the process, you know.
So there's a question about how do you decide to use your personal story as central to your art practice?
I'm wondering if it's a how or a why that I should be answering. I think it depends on the story, and if it feels like it's a compelling one, then that's it. And like just the nature of these home videos, it's like, oh, I could do something. I mean, you know, you watch that and like, oh, that's kind of fun. Like, you know, I hear things in the if we're taking that as an example, I can hear things in the just the din of noise of everyone yelling and screaming back and forth, and I go, well, there's something we could edit in that, or there's something we could tease out of that particular one. It depends on the story. I think the other two that we have tonight, in two cases, the story of what I'm seeing from these home videos informs, like, oh, what's this going to be? How do I interact with this as an adult? And in this third one, it's really a story I've been wanting to tell for a very long time. And I think the last thing I'll say about that, which is important, feels important, is the fact that sometimes it's really hard to tell the story while it's happening, even though I might want to. So to acknowledge, like, the benefit of being and take some time away from it and what hindsight will provide.
Excellent, thank you. How do you go about the process of creating something like that? How long does it take you? And who looks at it to help you?
I was grateful that one I could make through this residency process, because then it's naturally you sit in a room, this is before COVID, sit in a room with people, they watch it, they give you feedback. Somebody in that process of being in that cohort of people and a couple of faculty advisors, somehow in that they said, oh, why don't you take that, hey, how do you like that bicycle, Michael? Like, you could loop that, because of course he didn't just keep asking, but you know, in a way it sort of feels that way. It's like, I don't care about the bicycle, I want the makeup, you know, like, wait, sorry, I lost the question. Oh, how long does it take? Hours, an hour, 10, 20 hours, something like a 5-minute thing like that. It would take like 10, between 10, 15, 20 hours. And then this more recent one, which has been in dialogue with some collaborators, has taken a significant amount of time, just because it's going to change because of the dialogue. And so, especially because it's solo work, it's like, it's nice if it can exist not inside the vacuum of my mind, but in dialogue with people who are willing to go there with me, you know.
Are there any questions from the audience at this point? So the next piece that Michael is going to share, we've been having conversation about it since he's been here. There are things and ideas rolling around in his mind about how he wants to share it publicly and what his changing feelings are around it. So I'm going to ask you just to talk about that a little bit before we share it.
To that question, can I ask, can you see right there how many people are Zooming in? Or if not, that's fine. That's okay. Well, yeah, I think about the intimacy of a space with this piece because it uses the video projection of my first communion. So I grew up Catholic, and so this was one of the last. There are sacraments that you work your way through, and these landmarks and ones growing up and development that that represent different things, and that and this was probably one of the last ones that I actually did. However old you are, not very old, and. You know, for me, what's really liberating about this is that I feel sort of the violences of the Catholic Church affect me insofar as I feel a real hypocrisy around being a queer person who felt like, oh, I don't really have a place because it's demonized through that faith system. And so in one way, being able to tell stories around this ceremony feels like an act of reclamation, or I get to actually claim something of myself within this process and ritual that I feel very disconnected from, and I can only imagine that I felt more disconnected from it, even more so at the time, when there are these fundamental facts of my personhood just were not available to me. And also, I'm holding in, I wonder about like the intimacy of the space, like who's actually here, because if it feels enough like I'm just in my living room, maybe we could just project it on the wall and I'll show my parents this piece I do, because then it's like, it's still feeding me something, and I want to take care with the fact that this is still religious ceremony, and to make it like broadly public, I don't think that's necessarily fair to the people who were in that room back in the 90s who this really meant something for. And even in my trying to reclaim something or to stand up for myself within the confines of this faith system, I want to hold respect for other people's how it's meaningful for them. And so if like this was a sold out house, and if it, you know, like there'd be conditions in which I would say, I don't think I'm going to show that, but in the dialogue that we had, it felt like, okay, this is still small enough that I'm willing to share this, you know. The title's Hail Mary Cha-Cha-Cha, which came about just because of the rhythm of language that I get, it's ingrained with some of these prayers that we grow up with, and then also the rhythm of certain dances. It could have been any in some senses, but Cha-Cha-Cha has that triple rhythm, and then the prayer goes, Hail Mary, full of grace, and so to replace those three words with three other words that have a different kind of meaning for me, again, as an adult, felt like just kind of wordplay. But then there have been many versions of me trying to process my relationship with the Catholic Church under the title Hail Mary Cha-Cha-Cha, and this is the most recent one, and the only one that uses video projection. Thanks. And now we're striking this now, I believe, right? Okay, cool. Thank you.
Any questions on Zoom or from the house? Yeah, Anthony. So the question from the audience is just acknowledging the vulnerability that Michael's bringing to the space by sharing that, and asking how he feels about that situation now, and if it draws him back to that time, and how he is thinking about that now. Yes?
Thanks for that question. And I think I feel generally pretty good because I can frame it in a way that feels relevant to me now, which is like, claiming queerness, you know, like I'm gay, but like when I think about the way I've always been moving through the world, that's when I go, there's something, like that's when I can feel like there's something to me that I feel is just intrinsically queer, and so I hold those two identifiers, and being able to play, like to take that into, to play with structure, to play with media, like to think about that in terms of like a creative process, I have fun with that, and it feels like play to me, so. Thank you.
There's a question in the chat. What is Michael's choreography process like?
It's usually the movement comes last, and I'm working on it because I care so much about the stories that I'll write them, and I think of how to deliver them, sometimes to the detriment. Like, I identify ways that I wish I had embodied that text more. My really dear friend, close friend, my dance partner in the assisted living home, Sierra Surrett, said to me just the other day, she's like, you care about punctuation, right? Why aren't you dancing the punctuation then, right? I'm like, yeah, yes, exactly. So, I'm working to, and thanks to some of the feedback I got today on the newer work, which I know I have to get to soon, a process of trying to, you know, if you do care about this text, how can we embody, how can you, me, how can I embody that and really commit to the movement as much as I commit to the ideas that are buzzing around that gave rise to the whole idea in the first place, you know?
So the question is, how old were you when you started dancing?
I started dancing when I was 14 because you could take it instead of gym class at Lowell Public High School. So I said, yes, and that's where I met my friend Sierra, too. We've been dancing with each other since high school. Yeah, I know, right? So it was rare, I felt like, at the time it felt rare that there would be a dance program there, but yeah.
How do you edit your movement to fit the story?
It's interesting to hear that, because I know there is some editing that happens or some consideration of how to craft the movement. I think that I'm probably, what's feeling useful to me right now is not to edit, which to me kind of feels like a how to cut it off, but how to embody it and how to fill it out more. That feels like what I should be doing for an editing process, as opposed to what does this look like? You know, like, oh, what is, from my mind's eye, what does this look like? As opposed to like how to just be in it. That's an ongoing process for me.
Knowing you, your mind is always bubbling. There's some folks here in the room who know you too. Bubbling, bubbling, bubbling. But when you watch Michael live, you'll see the clarity of the movement. And it's so interesting because it's like your words and your story roll like an ocean. But your body is like, it's like butter, just like smooth. Like, you'll see what I mean in a few minutes. But it's interesting knowing you as a thinker, right, and as an advocate for your community. There's so much happening in the ways that you make connections through thoughts, ideas, philosophies, concepts, history. So that is interesting. Any other questions from the audience? Yeah, Lindsay. So the question is about how Michael perceives his movement as emotion coming from his stories. Is that good? Yeah, okay.
I'm holding on to that question, and I'm also aware that I think we have to turn this off. Oh, I see. That's what's happening. Thank you. I didn't know if it was turned off already. Thank you for that question, and I feel like very recently, less about choreographic process as you're seeing it tonight, and more about stuff that, it's not that people don't see it, but I'm attending to ways of movement being personal ritual and a way for, you know, if it's emotion, but it's also, for me, it's spirit, and it's it's connecting with ancestors and elders, and it's provides me something that, you know, maybe it would be harder for me to find in the faith system that I grew up in. Or I know that it is, right? But in we can call it improvisational, and if certainly informed by any of the different styles of dancing that I've studied, including partner dancing, but that to have that ritual for myself and to be able to process emotion and thought, and that it's not about, it's a big process for me, and I'm sure for others too, and I wonder the degree to which others who move and dance in the room feel this way. It's like, not about what it looks like, but something about, like, what is it, why? Like, why? And the idea that it could be about ritual. Just last December, there's an event that we do every year. Michael Dowling in Boston, visual artist, community organizer, arranges it. It's the Day Without Art on World AIDS Day on December 1st. I've been part of this event for years, but just last year, you know, there's COVID. I mean, they bring in the AIDS quilt. You can spend time with all the different panels and just try to feel connection with these individual people. And I collaborated with a beautiful violinist, Raph Horowitz. And something about that dialogue between us and the fact that it was for communing with these folks in the room. I was going to move. I mean, I was dancing, but it was not, for the first time, it was very freeing that the point was not about, like, does this look okay? Does everybody think this looks good? You know, like, which I get hung up on, you know?
Other questions? Yeah. So Sophia is, hi. asking if there's ever a time when Michael gets stuck in his process, and if he does, how he moves through that impasse.
Thank you for that question. And the answer to that for me that I'm holding on to, and I also think it applies to so many other aspects of my own life and practices, like, who's the community? Like, who are the people that are willing to, like, be there with me in process and just let ideas bounce off them? Like, especially if making something solo, like, I love working alone. There's part of that that really appeals to me, but, like, it can't all just happen there, right? And I think in particular, because it's solo work, just thinking about who are the people that I'm hiring, and, like, we have a contract, and you are the dramaturg, and so I want to make sure I respect that time. And then also my closest friends, you know, there's this overlap between friends and colleagues and, you know, professional relationships, but, like, who's willing to just be there in the room with you and offer their perspective? It happened early this afternoon with two friends that I've known longer and one that's new, you know, like, I think that, and then to lean into community and figuring out ways to be in community and the multiple overlapping ways that happens, I think is also just good for living life and answering other questions that come up, you know?
I think we should go live with Michael's performance. So Michael is going to share a brand new work. This is a work you've crafted over the past year? A year or so. Yeah. Yeah. And it will be premiered right here, right now, actually. But he'll also be showcasing this work at the Institute of Contemporary Art the weekend of March 18th, 19th, and 20th as part of NEFA, New England Foundation for the Arts Regional Dance Development Initiative for New England Artists. We also have Sarah in the room and Anthony, who will be showing work there as well. So I'll put that in the chat. Yeah.
You get your East Coast swing. You get your West Coast swing. You get your samba. No, not that kind of samba. Not that samba. It's a different kind of samba. It's a different kind of samba. It's a different samba. Anybody know West Side Story?
Yeah.
Mambo! Anybody know Saturday Night Fever?
Yeah.
Do the hustle. Does anybody know Strictly Ballroom? No, nobody. Paso Doble. What does this all mean, you might be asking? I'll tell you two things that it means. Number one, it means that this entire celluloid vision could all be yours in one easy payment, or two easy payments, or five easy payments. Really, whatever works for you. You really want the lessons, though, right? And number two, it means there is never a clear end point. It means you, if you like, could have dance lessons. You could teach dance lessons for the rest of your life! You know, in a queer ballroom dancing competitions, they let you lead and they let you follow. And what's more, you get higher marks for switching back and forth. There was an octogenarian instructor at the studio where I worked, and I only mention that he's octogenarian as it does fit into this overall timeline. He could corroborate the stories that the rest of us had heard about this bygone practice of selling lifetime dance packages, which meant that for one easy payment of $10,000, you could have dance lessons for the rest of your life! Yeah, yeah! He only ever sold one. He would have been roughly Johnny Castle's age in the movie Dirty Dancing as he was dancing on that fallen tree at the time that was meant to take place, 1963. But you know what was actually happening in 1968? The Florida District Court of Appeals is hearing the case of Vokes versus Arthur Murray. Audrey Vokes, recent widow, decides to pursue dance instruction from a dance instructor who proceeds over the course of 9 months to sell her 14 different dance packages for a total cash outlay of over $31,000. Vokes decides to sue because she realizes at some point the dance lessons are not helping her to become a better dancer, despite her instructor's many assurances to the contrary. After a lower court dismisses the case, the appellate court ultimately rules in Vokes' favor, concluding, quote, "It should have been reasonably apparent to defendants that her vast outlay of cash for many hundreds of additional hours of dance instruction were not justified by her slow and awkward progress," end quote. So, the appellant was entitled to her day in court. Come with me. What's up? Right. The timeline. Gotta get to the timeline. Well, it's a timeline, if not the timeline. Arthur Murray is born in New York City, and in 1904, the Imperial Society of Teachers of Dancing is established in London, England, and it's going to go on to originate the medal test system, which is basically the very first ever trophy system, certifying dance instructors through the levels: bronze, silver, gold. It's a system that is widely established and adopted by many, including the Arthur Murray Dance Studios, which is founded in 1925 and franchised in 1938. Now, in 1948, the National Dance Council of America is established, and it's going to go on to write the rule books and sanction the competitions that happen here to this day in what is commonly known as the United States of America. Quick sidebar, though, if we move it ahead about 71 years, you're going to get to 2019. That's the year that the National Dance Council of America finally amended Rule 2A6A, the definition of a couple, such that now a leader can lead and a follower can follow, quote, without regard to the sex or gender of the dancer, end quote. The fact that it took 71 years to get there is the reason that queer ballroom dancing competitions were ever organized in the first place. And it's how it happened that alternative sanctioning bodies were ever organized, including the North American Same-Sex Partner Dance Association, of which I did serve on the board from 2013 until 2015, which is neither here nor there, because the point is that it took 71 years for the National Dance Council of America to officially acknowledge they're going to need some other options! 2019, just in time for a lockdown. You got that right. Anyhow, 1987. Dirty Dancing depicts one version of events as they might have occurred back in 1963, and if you move it ahead a little over 10 years, you're gonna find me thoroughly befuddled, sitting and holding hands with Jen Squalia on her grandmother's couch. 1991, Arthur Murray passes away at his home in Honolulu, Hawaii. And in 1992, the Federal Trade Commission issues a cautionary brochure for consumers of ballroom dancing, warning them against some of the more concerning sales tactics that instructors have been known to employ by that time. Look, you can do it with me if you want, but you don't have to, okay? But if you want to, the first thing you do, you're gonna take your fingertips, you're gonna put them together just like that, gently, gently. Just as much tone as it takes to hold a piece of paper there, right? You get it? Now, hook your fingertips and move your elbows away from one another. Do you feel that? That is the pull, okay? So now next, here's what you're gonna do. You take that part, the tops of your fingers on the one side, and this part, the heel of your palm on the other side, and gently, you're going to move your elbows toward that point. Do you feel that? That's the push, all right? So there's a pull and there's a push. But it's about understanding where the midpoint is. You don't wanna be getting jerked around, and you don't wanna be jerking anybody around. And yet still there is this tension, and it does kind of hold everything together. Do you have your venue? Good. Do you have your florist? Good. Do you have your outfits? Oh, great! Oh, I'm just so happy for you! All right, so when's the big day? That soon. Wow, no, no, it's fine, it's fine. We'll just have to get our rears in gear. I said, oh, that's fine, no. What's your song? Oh, fantastic, that's a foxtrot. I love that song. But you want a waltz. Oh, well, what the fuck? Okay, fine. No, it's fine. It's fine. No, we can make that work. We can make that for you, anything. Lovebirds! Ah! All right, well, here's the first thing that you're gonna learn. You're gonna take the heel of your palm, okay? And you're gonna take the heel of your palm, and very gently, I said, you're gonna put them together. Gentle, just as much tone as it would take to hold a piece of paper there. Yeah, that's it. You got it. Yeah, absolutely. Gentle, yes, almost there. Yep.
Mm.
We have time for just a few questions, and I'll take them on the chat or in the house. Do you have water?
I do.
You should drink it. There's a question about how you decided to tell that particular story.
Because I worked for a ballroom franchise for 7 years, and I am considering now what it means to dance these various dances and what is implicated in a history of this franchise system, which has codified a variety of dances with origins all over the world. And in particular, my inquiry is looking at what might the implications be, or what are the responsibilities that attends to the fact that this system has codified and marketed dances of the global south in order to be made marketable and sold to a majority white and largely affluent audience. What do we do with that? And I think that this is a process, it's ongoing, but to process it and to consider these questions is certainly a part of it. To name the history of the different dances feels like another part of it, and that's an ongoing process for me. And then to rethink the structures that support the practice of ballroom dancing, to me that's a big reason why I do it in assisted living at all, is because it feels to me like an act of resistance in this very niche, particular corner of the dance world, or it feels like something that that feels right for those reasons. So that's why.
So you have curated and helped organize a program called Dancing Queerly. Can you talk about that and talk about how your act of showing up in the community helps inform your artistic practice and vice versa?
Try. Dancing Queerly was something that a friend of mine, Maggie C., established in 2018. We wrote a grant to put together a festival, and at the time, and for 2018 and 2019, that's just what it was. So it's performances, workshops, discussions, and when we could gather then, it was also social dance gatherings by and for LGBTQ+ community. At the time, it was very much curation. It was getting the money to be able to figure out where are we renting the space, who are we paying, in some cases, who are we bringing in order to have this particular, this roster and this programming. And of course, with COVID, everything about live events changed. And also, in those years since, a real consideration for, is an annual festival that model serving us? And so what it's shifting toward is a platform that will first ask what do queer dance makers or queer dance practitioners in the area or beyond the area, what might be useful? What do you actually need? Do you need a performance, or do you need some research and development time? And trying to keep those questions about what the need is for the community to foreground that, as opposed to the presentation and let's get the marketing materials out there, and just in that reframing, hoping that that it can be increasingly grounded in community and to expand that, and also but to deepen it as we go along. And at the time, I will say that the grant that we initially wrote, part of why we got that was because Maggie and I, it was meant that we would be showcasing and performing our own work. And we did the first year and then the second year. And then specifically after that, it was let's not focus on us, the ones producing and the ones holding the reins on all this, but thinking about guest curation and thinking about ways to be able to, again, create a system or a model that's going to serve the community rather than relying on this thing that we had gotten to know and also putting our work in it. Felt for a couple of years there that does not make sense if we're trying to work with an uplift of other artists. And now I'm also still not producing my own work, but definitely considering how I'm a part of that and not neglecting my own personal artistic practice in working toward for this other community effort.
Questions from the house? One last question. Who are you inspired by currently?
Alice Shepard and Kinetic Light Company is a big inspiration. I've been able to witness their work only remotely, but it speaks to disability aesthetics in a way that opens up possibilities that I think are really exciting, and my experience of the work is enhanced by the poetry of the captions and the musicality. If I'm to close my eyes and to witness the work by listening to the sound score, I'm getting something out of it that's very particular to that experience. And I identify as non-disabled myself, and there's something about the richness of thinking about all these different ways of attending to the work that's really inspirational to me. And also, during the earlier days of COVID, Alice Shepard and Emily Johnson, who is a choreographer of the Yupik Nation, and they were in conversation together, and it spoke so much to not just like the work, but also the ways of beginning, the ways of having a conversation. It spoke to me about vulnerability in a space, and also that particular event spoke to a willingness of the presenter to go there with them. So I think about those artists who I just draw a lot of inspiration, and others, but those two come to mind, especially as I'm in this conversation with you and your own willingness to be able to craft this event in this particular way. So I can turn that back as a thank you.
And thank you to all of you who are joining us here in person. We so appreciate you showing up for dance. And thank you to all of you on Zoom. We appreciate you joining us remotely. I hope that the links were helpful. And if you would like to see Michael's work upcoming in the very near future, I'll just reiterate that he will be at the Institute of Contemporary Art the weekend of March 18th through 20th as part of the Regional Dance Development Initiative. For folks who are on Zoom, I've dropped that information in the chat. So thank you, everyone, and have a great evening.